if you have a single atom in a cubic meter, that plasma will cover the whole cubic meter.
Two, three core layers, rotating layers, used for defense of the system for high speed and what we call protection, like in the cosmic dust. You use your reactor, the first two inner cores maintains your gravitational magnetic field. The third and the fourth you control with your subsidiary reactors for shielding in the direction of strength. So what you do, you bring in your third, which works in the outer boundary, and you use one of your 120 degree reactors to strengthen the shield in the direction of the motion. So you have two layers. This is part of the defense. And I'm sure Iranian governments use it in their space technology, especially for capture and landing. You have to maintain your gravitational, but you increase your dimension with your third and a fourth reactor. This is very important when you travel into or you create variation magnetic field testing, that you can get away with the first shield, use a central core plasma. Central core plasma, very much like a sun, then you have to know how to create different layers of magnetic field in your plasma core. You do it in a specific way through different material. Centralization does not just come with hydrogen and helium. In the body of the man is done in by four different elements. In our amino acid. So if you learn that, you can convert it into practical reactors. But the glass tube you have there is very, very, very interesting. I've seen the guy is doing on the internet. He shows a plasma and he plays with it. This American guy has recently come on the scene.
The primer fields, I think that's called. Is that correct?
I don't know. I've seen one of his videos. It's a nonsense. He literally, when we were talking to you, it's like a globe you have in the back of your picture on your what do you call it? All he's doing, he's making a glorified version of this. Yeah, we use this in the labs, in the physics, in the secondary schools.
That's true.
So what he's done, he creates what he calls a plasma, and he puts current to it. So it shows the light, or he says this is a plasma and this is what it's doing with it. This is something, it's been done in the 1950s.
It was done back in the 1910s and 20s even, with they were experimenting with the high voltage and showing that the effects of the galaxy are created by doing that, you know.
High voltage, you don't need high current. If you look at the video we put on our forum about our reactor, and if you look at the power supply, we use very, very little, very little.
You were using about 150 volts is the way I was reading it. Is that correct?
No, we don't. The system maximum uses, we use a 9-volt battery, rechargeable battery, to run the operation in testing.
Wow.
Okay.
When you do a rechargeable battery, you connect your battery to your motor to start your running, and then you take the energy from your reactor once the plasma is created to recharge your battery, so you become supply independent. Hmm. This is how you isolate from control from outside. If you have a power supply, you have a line connected going through your shielding, let's say, and you can't have that.
Right.
Simply look at the Columbus, the shuttle. When they come back and they come in the wrong angle, they give it birth. If you create a field, you have to maintain control it internally because the shielding will not allow you to go anywhere else. You become isolated. You become insulated. So we have chambers built internally. We have even gas chambers built internally for control and feed. You cannot work with a cable power supply. You have to build your power supply internally as part of your reactor.
Yes, we've been playing with that high voltage thing just to see different effects and see what happens with our, like we take a plasma ball, which when you hold it this way with this little column in the middle, it looks almost identical to your patent, actually. When you, I can actually hold the your patent up here. If you can see this, and I hold this right in front, and it matches exactly the patent.
Yes, but look at the drawings around it. There's a lot of information in that drawing.
You bet, yeah. But it's interesting that the gases inside this little plasma globe are inert gases, many of which are the same as in your reactor. So that's why we started sort of, well, I got the idea anyway, to start playing with a plasma ball, just to learn more about it. What happens to a plasma ball when you put it in a vacuum? What happens when you spin it at 4,000 RPM? So we did those experiments. And we.
And what was your result?
Well, when we spun it at... You can see the central tendril is forming there now, 1,000 or so RPM. So we have this plasma globe. It's got the gases inside, and we decided
to... What gases
do
you have in?
Well, normally there's argon and possibly some neon and other gases along that same range, possibly some helium, depending on the colors in each particular plasma globe. Apparently, quite often they use argon and
xenon. This is something you bought off the shelf.
Yeah, you buy these for like $40, and it's got...
Yeah, I know. I thought you made it yourself.
It's got a high voltage power supply all ready to go. No, that's the thing about it. It's already made. In fact, I've already taken the bulb, the glass part, out of the bottom, and we put it inside of a vacuum chamber that I made here. You can see the bulb sitting inside there.
And
then we've run it with high voltage from an automobile coil system, 40, 50,000 volts and so on. And in fact, well, we could try it here right now, actually, just to show you what it looks like. You get a purple plasma happening inside the chamber, basically.
What color is it before?
Well, the ball itself will be like a normal... It's normally this color with the tendrils that are blue and so on. We go ahead and turn the vacuum on there.
No, there's no the power thing. The cable.
Just a second here.
This is what you call a live performance?
Yes, that's right, exactly. We change things on the fly. Last week we probably changed the chamber 100 times and tried 100 experiments in a couple of hours. Do you want to get ready for that light there too? We'll do that. So this is on. I'm not sure if you can see that there. I might have to lift it up. It gets a little dangerous. Oops, we lost it there. Can you turn the power off? Yeah.
Okay.
Can you kill that kitchen light there, Paul? Hello, can you see that at all? It's kind of dark.
It's bluish something.
Yeah, it's bluish and purplish inside there. you can actually move it a little closer. You have to be really careful. Up the wires up.
Rick?
Yeah?
Mr. Keshe cannot hear us.
Come back. The minute you touch something, you got up even there.
Maybe it was some of the high voltage might have affected things. It's entirely possible. It'll kick out my cell phone when I get it too close.
Okay, sure.
We can try that again here. We're going to have to kill the big light.
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
Turn it off.
Yeah.
Ask if they can see anything.
Can you see anything there, or is it too dark?
It's too dark in the back. Yeah, I see the plasma in the line now.
Yeah, it's just starting to sort of get going there now with the, as the pressure drops.
How come we don't have it?
I don't know. It's different this time. So, depending on some of the... There, that's a different effect now than when it's at the very high vacuum. Just takes a little bit of vacuum that's less to create a totally different sort of phenomenon there. And right now that...
Okay.
Pardon me?
Do you understand the reason behind it?
Well, I understand that the plasma changes with the pressure quite a bit in terms of the way the
you have a gas tube inside. The pressure doesn't do that, has nothing to do with the pressure. When you vacuum the system, is literally you reduce the number of the elements inside, so you allow the plasma of a proton of what is inside the chamber to open up, so your plasma inside the light connects through to the energy or the magnetic field of the gas element which is outside it, which you withdrew. So in fact, it's a connection of magnetic fields that allows the different shape of the plasma. The more you extract, it's just like a balloon, it opens up more. So the plasma is freer. This is how you generate electricity or power. When you create a vacuum, you allow one or two or let's say a very limited number of plasmas or atoms in. You strip it. Now you play with the game. This is a very nice way to show the opening of a plasma. Here in a normal condition, when you're not a plasma, it's like having 20, 30 blankets on top of you.
Exactly.
As you take the blankets away, the plasmas which are left in there is no full vacuum state in the universe.
Right.
Vacuum is a wrong word in the vocabulary. There is nowhere in the universe which some magnetic fields are not traveling through it.
And even having hydrogen atoms and so on in every square or every cubic centimeter, there's a few.
That single, if you have a single atom in a cubic meter, that plasma will cover the whole cubic meter. Yeah. So
right.
When you
this is a hard concept to get
this
heads around. But I've run across this. I understand what you mean, but it's a big one.
It is exactly like a gas.
Yeah.
But the behavior of plasma is exactly like a gas. It fills its container. You understand?
Yes, so, definitely.
So when you reduce, when you take so many atoms out of your cylinder, you allow the very few plasmas which are outside the tube to open up. And in opening up, you allow the energy transfer across.